examples that I'll be joking. So the title of my talk today is CMB Non-Gaussianity as a probe of primordial magnetic fields. In particular, I'm going to talk about one calculation that we've done to calculate the trispectrum sourced by primordial magnetic fields and use that to put some upper limits on the strength of these primordial magnetic fields. This is work that I've done in collaboration with my PhD supervisors, Professor Seshadri and Professor Subramanian. And this is work that has appeared a few months ago in June here. The outline of my talk is, in the beginning, I'll talk a little bit about large-scale magnetic fields in the universe, about some observations and what may be the origin of such large-scale magnetic fields. Then I'll talk a little bit about what are the imprints that these fields can leave on the CMB, which allows us to probe the larger-scale magnetic fields. Then I'll talk about the work we've done on CMB non-Gaussianity, sourced by these putative magnetic fields. And I'll talk a little bit about the bispectrum, but I'll focus a little bit more on the trispectrum because it's the work we've done most recently, and it also gives the strongest constraints on the strength of these primordial magnetic fields from all probes so far on the larger scales. magnetic fields are seen all through the universe. In fact, they are ubiquitous. I think every bound object larger than the Earth has a magnetic field. But I'm more interested in the large scale magnetic fields. So we can probe magnetic fields on the scales of the galaxies using synchrotron radio radiation. So here you see M51, and these are the vectors that show the directions of the inferred magnetic field on the plane of the sky using the synchrotron radiation. And here you see just that part of the radiation polarized. In this case, it is for the galaxy NGC 6946. We see the evidence of magnetic fields of strength about 5 to 10 microgauss in many, many such galaxies. And we see evidence for magnetic fields both of a kind of coherent type as well as of a random type, both with strengths of few microgauss on scales that are as large as 10 kiloparsecs or more. And this is seen ubiquitously in these kind of galaxies. If we jump up scale from the individual galaxies to the clusters of galaxies, we can use Faraday rotation to try and infer what is the magnetic field in the clusters of galaxies. So on the y-axis here, you have the rotation measure, and on the x-axis, you have the impact parameter for the line of sight through the cluster. And so over here, you can see that these are objects which have some polarization, and they're sort of in the background. And when we look at them through large impact parameter, you don't see anything really. But as you go towards the core of the cluster, you can see that you have a magnetic field that spreads out to about 1 megaparsec in the scale of the cluster. So even the clusters seem to be magnetized. And it's a big sort of challenge. How do you form it? Magnetic field, which is 1 megaparsec large, to span a cluster.
Is that a single cluster, or is that a correlation?
This is for 16 Arden clusters.
So there's some azimuthal structures. Why you get the negative points and positive points?
So the direction of the rotation measure, it can be sort of negative or positive. It's actually basically saying, what is the magnetic field along the line of sight? So if there is some magnetic field in the cluster, it could be in that direction along the line of sight, or it could be in this direction. So you would expect that there'd be as many points here as up here, so on average. So we see these magnetic fields out to large scales. And the growth of these magnetic fields can be explained due to dynamo action. Or it could be explained due to flux that has been frozen in to the matter while the matter has collapsed during structure formation. In either case, you need a seed field. You can't have a microgauss field where there was none to begin with. And the seed field, it may be astrophysical or it may be primordial in origin. It may be something that comes to us from the early universe. Now, so I'm going to talk about basically this aspect, which is what if there's a primordial electromagnetic field, and there's two observations, so two of several observations, let's say, but these two I just want to talk about a little bit, which give us more reason to think very closely about the idea of a primordial magnetic field, rather than these seed fields just being astrophysical. We see that there are equally strong magnetic fields even in those galaxies, even at higher redshift. So if you see 10 microgauss magnetic fields in high redshift galaxies, high redshift here means a redshift of 2, let's say. That means that the dynamo would have had to form and would have needed enough time to act and reach saturation. And at that redshift, you have only about 1 giga year or so. So it's not clear whether the dynamo can do the job just till that time. And then there's this recent evidence from the Fermi satellite where they've observed, where they tried to observe the gamma ray halos all around blazars. And from this observation, they managed to set a lower limit on the intergalactic magnetic field. This is the first kind of thing which is very interesting observation. It has also been, several articles have also appeared saying this is wrong or it could be due to something else. But this is very interesting. This is the first time somebody has set a lower limit on a magnetic field, and also claim that this magnetic field spans the volume of space. It's there even in the voids. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this. Both these observations lead us to believe that primordial magnetic fields should be considered pretty seriously. So this slide is from the Gibbian work. Basic idea is this: you have the blazar, it sends out the radiation at very high energies, which then pair produces on the extragalactic background light. These pairs will then upscatter the CMB to give you GeV sort of radiation, slightly lower in energy. And this GeV will then, it will appear in a sort of a halo where to begin with you just had a source that was just a point. Now if this whole thing happens out in the intergalactic space in the presence of a magnetic field, an intergalactic magnetic field, that will tend to make our pairs go in these curved sort of directions. They will tend to sort of diverge out in the presence of a magnetic field. So what you will get is a GeV halo, but it will be spread so far wide that it will no longer be sort of detected. So what these, what the earlier authors found was that they looked for these GeV halos all around the blazars, and they found none. Of course, there are only small numbers of these objects. As you can imagine, this is circumstantial evidence. It's indirect evidence. It's not, pinching proof of a primordial magnetic field or some intergalactic magnetic field. But it's very, tantalizing. And this is something that has also received alternative explanations. I think there was one paper by Broderick Chang and Frommer that said that, well, you don't need a magnetic field to have a, GeV halo that you don't see. It could be just two-stream instability. And then there have been some other articles. There's, I think last week there was an article on AstroPH by Miniati who said, no, you do need magnetic fields, and this is a good probe of magnetic fields. So, the jury is out on this, but it leads us to consider primordial magnetic fields with more immediacy. What are the constraints on the cosmic magnetic field? So this is the scale or the correlation length of the magnetic field, log of that in megaparsecs, and this is the amplitude, or the log of the amplitude of the magnetic field. So that lower limit that we're getting from the Fermi observations sits somewhere over here, let's say. And we have constraints at smaller scales from the Zeeman effect. We have a bound from Big Bang, the nuclear synthesis. These are the observed magnetic fields in the galaxies and the cluster of the galaxies. And then we have other bounds from the rotation or the polarization, as well as the CMB. This is the bound that comes from the CMB from basically the magnetic effects of the power spectrum. And that bound we can see is roughly of a few nanogauss. That's sort of the upper limit for magnetic field. All these areas in sort of orange, they kind of indicate what strengths and scales of magnetic field you could hope to produce in phase transitions of different kinds. This would be the electroweak and recombination and also the QCD.
What about the energy?
From the new distortion, or
comparable,
yes, that would all. I think I don't remember the exact number. I think it was about 5 or 10 nanogauss. I'm not sure actually. Yeah, maybe it was about.
It's larger than the than the bounce from the CMB.
Yes, it's larger.
I don't remember.
Yeah. Maybe it's about 10 to the minus 8 gauss or a little bit more than that.
Yeah,
whereas you know, the power spectrum gets you down to about 2 to 5 nanogauss.
I just had a quick question. You can go back to your
slide.
I'm just not sure how is this data scale that you have. So you have observations of galaxies and clusters on the same plot that you have like CMB bounds. And so how is this scale so that these are the CMB? This is the CMB you need, magnetic field you need to create the current stuff in galaxies and clusters.
Yeah. So actually, this diagram is a kind of hodgepodge.
Okay.
It's like a schematic. It's not a serious sort of diagram in that way. It's just showing what all are the bounds and what are the observations of magnetic fields and at what scales we observe them.
Right. So
it doesn't necessarily mean that this becomes that.
Right. So you're not saying that the CMB bound is excluding primordial origin of different galaxies and clusters.
No. I'm not saying that. No.
But the CMB bound is the extrapolated magnetic field you would have now.
Yes. Yes. It is an extrapolation, and it is the value now. There's been a lot of work that's been done theoretically on what could be the origin of a primordial magnetic field. Right now there is no compelling mechanism that solves all the issues. The generic thing that must be done is you must break the conformal invariance of electromagnetism in order to get a substantial magnetic field from an earlier epoch that was done. The best candidate is inflation, but all the models to generate a magnetic field from inflation have this big problem of back reaction, where once you generate a magnetic field, it tends to stall inflation itself or tends to spoil it or the model in some ways. And also there are various sort of other issues which I really won't go into right now. Another alternative is you can form magnetic fields from phase transitions in the early universe, the QCD, or maybe as late as the electron beam. But these phase transitions will produce a magnetic field with a small correlation length, and then you have to transport that magnetic field to larger scales via a kind of inverse cascade. And it's not clear that inverse cascade can be efficient enough to give you a kind of magnetic field that fills the universe that is really like a cosmic magnetic field now. And then there are various sort of other ideas of how people form a primordial magnetic field as well, from their defects and supersymmetry, string theory. Since I have not really worked in the origin of magnetic fields, I work more in sort of what are the observable sort of consequences. I won't go into that, but I thought I'd just mention this. Primordial magnetic fields will affect not only the CMB, but they will also affect Big Bang, the nucleosynthesis, the first stars, the reionization, as well as the growth and formation of structure in the universe. I'll talk about the CMB only. There are several modes that you get from magnetic fields in the CMB power spectrum, and they are shown here in this diagram made by Richard. So this red line is the CMB for the power spectrum from inflationary for the radiance. And then these three lines over here are the magnetic modes from the scalar and the vector and the tensor mode, all from magnetic fields. You can see that the vector mode actually does not get affected by SIP damping. In fact, the vector mode comes from the damping of arcanic waves, which are not affected by SIP damping. So therefore, you can look at high L for the signature of your power, magnetic fields. Recently, there was one paper by Pavletti et al. That has combined the data from the WMAP and SPT in a kind of a way to look for this thing and to look at the signature. So they've also put some constraints using the power spectrum on primordial magnetic fields. So magnetic fields will give rise to metric perturbations, both from the energy density as well as the anisotropic stress. And these will lead to fluctuations in the CMB due to a kind of magnetic saturation. This is what I'm going to use to do my non-Gaussianity sort of calculations. And the work that Richard has done with Anthony Lewis showed that there is another mode apart from these three, which is called the passive mode, which are these two bands here. This is the tensor passive mode, this is the passive mode for the scalars. And this is due to the interplay between neutrinos and the magnetic field. So the magnetic anisotropic stress is there until the epoch of neutrino, you know, decoupling. And when neutrinos will, you know, decouple from the background, they will also produce some anisotropic stress, and this will quickly become equal and opposite to the one from the magnetic field, so that the net anisotropic stress is, you know, zero. So after your neutrino decoupling, the anisotropic stress mode evolves like an adiabatic type of mode, and it evolves in the sense like a kind of passive mode, hence the name. This mode has 50 times stronger, you know, amplitude when it comes to the magnetic sites mode, and therefore, instead of, you know, the magnetic effects being this low, they now become quite appreciable. And also, you know, the delta T by T is now proportional to the epoch at which you generated your magnetic field. That's not the case for these modes, but it is the case for, you know, the passive mode. However, the model dependence is weak because it is logarithmic. So this TB is, you know, the temperature of the universe when you form the magnetic field. So for our calculations, what we've done is we've taken this as a reheating temperature, and this is, you know, the temperature where the neutrinos, you know, decouple. Already there are constraints on primordial magnetic fields from the power spectrum, and this is being done by various authors. And the constraints are somewhere between around 5 nanogauss going down to about 2 nanogauss, somewhere in that sort of you know, region. There are various sort of other effects in the CMB from primordial magnetic fields to do with the polarization. In fact, primordial magnetic fields also give rise to a unique sort of B mode. There's a lot of interest in that as well. I'm not going to talk about that right now, as well as, you know, the location of the polarization. And there's another effect where the acoustic peaks get shifted to a slightly higher end because of the presence of magnetic fields. but let me now jump straight to non-Gaussianity, which is the work that we do.
Can you also tell us about how it affects
BBN? How does it affect BBN? At the simplest sort of level, there is a more sort of energy density from magnetic fields. Uh-huh. So if you have too much, it will spoil your abundance. But that's a very gross description. There's more to it than that. Yeah. I mean, at the kind of lowest order. Why is CMB non-Gaussianity so important from magnetic fields? So when you look at non-Gaussianity from inflation, you have small fluctuations in the field, that is, the linear order will dominate. And that means that the fluctuations of your field will have the Gaussian type of statistics. That means that the CMB, at its anisotropy, will behave in sort of the Gaussian type of way at lowest order. So if I write down the perturbations in the potential like this, where this is the linear order, this is the quadratic order, and the cubic order, and we write this is, you know, the coefficient or the quadratic component of this field, called the FNL, and the coefficient or the cubic one, which is the GNL, then it's clear that any primordial non-Gaussianity in the CMB can arise only as a higher order effect from these terms. So it's just a higher order effect. This is not the case when you consider non-Gaussianity from primordial magnetic fields, because the magnetic sort of effects, which are, you know, the energy density and the stress, they are inherently quadratic in the magnetic field. Both of these goes at, you know, they won't go as B squared. Hence, even if the magnetic field is pure Gaussian, their effects will be entirely non-Gaussian. And therefore, therefore you will have non-Gaussianity in the fluctuations in the CMB, which are induced by a magnetic field. So, magnetic fields source CMB non-Gaussianity even at their lowest order. And this brings me to perhaps the most important point, which is that even a very small amount of primordial magnetic field will produce an appreciable amount of non-Gaussianity. This is, in a sense, the most important thing, because this has also led us to do the calculations that I've done.
But this is because you're considering omega v. You can consider omega whatever particle is standing equal to the field, you have non-Gaussianity.
Right. So. But would you expect that to give like non-Gaussianity, like in that other case?
So I would expect that if they have any additional light particle.
Right. Yes, but
the infraton is special because, right.
So I agree with you that this comparison is to the infraton. This will not be the same thing if I compare it to some other particle.
the magnetic field that we are talking about is a stochastic.
It's a stochastic magnet, yeah. So I'm going to come to that. That I'm not going to be actually, you know, I'm not going to try to talk about a homogeneous magnetic field. You could think of a case where it's a homogeneous magnetic field that fills the universe. What that will do is it will induce a quadrupole and will break the isotropy of the universe. There are already strong bounds on that. So we don't want to really discuss homogeneous. We want to discuss the magnetic field that is statistically homogeneous and isotropic, but stochastic.
So is the correlation not enough to explain the
observed? Yes. So the the observations that we have of magnetic fields are only about 1 megapascal. So in a sense, the answer to your question will only come if we have confirmed observations on even longer scales. But so far, yes. So we know about non-Gaussian distributions. Third moment gives you how skewed they are. Fourth moment gives you, you know, the kurtosis. For delta T by T of the CMB, we expanded in terms of spherical harmonics of the sky, and we write the ALM in the harmonic space, and therefore we use things like the bispectrum and, you know, the trispectrum, which is the third order correlation in harmonic space and the fourth order of the anisotropies of the CMB. We use them to gain a handle on how much non-Gaussianity there is in the distribution of the CMB. So these are the quantities that we want, you know, to calculate, but now we want to see them sourced by magnetic fields. And as you know, the primordial non-Gaussianity from inflation has been defined in terms of this sort of bispectrum and in terms of this parameter, which is known as the Eckener parameter. And we can define a reduced bispectrum, BL1, L2, L3, which can be related to the FML or something like this. So I'm going to now, so what we did was, we did a calculation where, you know, the bispectrum was not sourced by inflationary perturbations, but instead it was sourced by the stochastic magnetic field, and we then compared it to this. And we know that non-Gaussianity has not yet been observed in the CMB, but there are bounds on it from your double map. And these are the bounds on the FML in a parameter. The 2 sigma bounds are that the FNL lies between minus 10 and 74. So we can use this, having done the non-Gaussianity calculation for magnetic fields, to put an upper bound on the strength of magnetic fields.
The bispectrum, what physical variable does that have? The temperature?
Yes, so it's the 3-point correlation of the anisotropy rate and the temperature. So 1 to 3 on the sky. And then we do the correlation, except that here we are doing the calculation in harmonic space rather than in, you know, the real space analysis. So we're basically asking how much is sort of the correlation between, you know, the anisotropy and three different directions. And then how much is that affected by the presence of a magnetic field?
Magnetic field doesn't directly source.
The magnetic
field.
Right, yeah. But here what I'm going to do is I'm going to consider just a magnetic saxwell effect. I'm going to say let that give me the anisotropy. And let me calculate the bispectrum due to just that effect and see how large that is. So it's like a restricted thing that I'm doing here. Yeah. I'm not looking at all the other effects. So to do the calculation, we don't want to look at the homogeneous magnetic fields. There are strict sort of upper limits on that from the isotropy or the CMB. Instead, we consider the stochastic magnetic field. The magnetic field will induce, you know, like a velocity field due to the Lorentz force. On scales that are larger than, you know, galactic scale, these velocities are very small. So the magnetic fields that induce these velocities are themselves not changed by these velocities. We can ignore the magnetic action on the magnetic field due to the Lorentz force induced velocities. And this is a big help. And then also the universe is highly conducting in terms of the plasma, so the magnetic fields are frozen into the matter distribution. And what this means is that we can separate evolution in terms of time of the magnetic field as just B of x and 1 by a squared in time. This is also a big simplification. With these things, and we, you know, we received a non-helical sort of, you know, magnetic field, and we kind of, if you choose kind of Gaussian sort of random fields, then we know that all that we want to know about the field is described by its group of the correlation function. So M of K is kind of power spectrum from my magnetic field.
When you say non-negligible, do you mean not expected negligible, or do you mean non-negligible?
I mean that for the calculation I've done, I've assumed a non-helical field. I could have introduced one part that's helical and one part that's not.
Cool. That's right. In general, you're in a field. In general, they'll have zero expected velocity, but it'll have some variance.
Right, so you're saying locally they may be non-zero velocity. But so when you do the realizations, you have to pay.
They're watching these things.
You have to pay close attention to how you know. Actually, what you know. So there's a way of doing the realizations where you can have a magnetic field in the realizations with no density problem. But here I'm doing. So yeah, I should have mentioned that here what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to do a calculation that is just analytic for the bi spectrum and the tri spectrum. So yeah, but when you do realizations, one has to. Here I just not so here basically what I've done is PIJ, this is the projection operator that ensures the divergence P is equal to and then I write this V dot V in terms of this delta square which is in terms of M of K. And the M of K, which is in the power spectrum of the magnetic field, I take as sort of this the power law. And the power law ends at the alpha wave. The damping speed. And this N is the index for the power law, and it's minus 3 for the magnetic field, for the power spectrum to be scalar invariant. And that's the one that we're going to choose for the calculation, because also that's the one that we expect based on various observations and various samples. So now we need to fix the amplitude of this. So the amplitude is fixed in terms of the variance of our stochastic and our magnetic field at a scale of 1 megaparsec. That's what we have in this. So with these inputs, I'm going to show you just the results for the bispectrum, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about the calculation for the trispectrum. When we did the calculation for the bispectrum, we got an amplitude for the bispectrum, which is about 10 to the minus 16. And this led to sort of upper limits on the magnetic field, the 3 nanogauss or about 2 nanogauss. This is just using the magnetic Stats-Mohs effect and doing the calculation for the bispectrum. This can be compared to the earlier calculation, the first calculation of the magnetic and the bispectrum, so I should mention that here one has done a calculation for the anisotropic stress, whereas early on it was done for the energy density, and that gave a bispectrum that is a million times weaker. And the magnetic field limit, you see the magnetic field goes as, for the bispectrum, goes as magnetic field to the power 6. So 6 orders of magnitude here translate to 1 order of magnitude over here. That's the improvement that we get. And of course, this is the this is the value that you get from inflation. I should also mention that we are doing these kind of calculations in a sort of analytic way. But there's been numerical evaluation of the magnetic bispectra done by Shiraishi et al. From Nagoya, and they've also looked at the vector mode and the tensor mode, and they're also able to get sort of upper limits on the magnetic field. This is the value of the co-moving magnetic field. Now at a 1 megaparsec scale. So you can see that they also get about 2 to 5 or 2.5, 4.5 nanogauss. And has also been worked done on the bispectrum by these objects. I'm going to talk a little bit now at the end about trispectrum. So I'm going to show you a little bit about how we've done the calculation. So we want to first look at the trispectrum sourced by energy density. We take the Sachs-Wolfe effect, and so this is the magnetic sort of energy density, and this is the coupling, and this coupling is recently sort of being evaluated by several authors, Caprini et al. 2010, I think, to get this kind of sort of value for that. And then we write down the ALM for this delta G by T, which looks like this, and then we want to calculate its 4-point correlation to get in the trispectrum, and so it looks like this, where this part over here is the 4-point correlation of the energy density of magnetic fields in Fourier space. This part is an 8-point correlation of the magnetic fields themselves. itself, because remember each of these is big square, and then we use weak scale to reduce our 8-point correlation to products of 2-point correlations. And the 2-point correlations we have already sort of defined when we wrote down the 2-point correlation of the magnetic field, the assumed geomagnetic field for our calculation. So although we have 105 terms, we can neglect 45 of them because there is 1 point in the circumference. And 12 of them are the unconnected terms. That leaves us 48 terms. That's still a lot for the analytic calculation. So a long calculation, I just call it a long calculation, on the remaining terms gives us a mode coupling integral that looks something like this. So you get out this kind of, you know, delta function, because when we wrote the 2-point correlation, we assumed, you know, already. And this is the mode coupling integral which has this kind of structure. It's more complicated now when we try to calculate the trispectrum. In the bispectrum, you had m of something into m of something into m of the third thing. Now you have four m's, 1, 2, 3, 4, so you get six terms out of it, and each one comes with their own angular structure. This diagram I have adapted from Bacon, Shellard, and Ferguson. This S, which we have to integrate over to the mode coupling integral, this vector, which we call a radial for space, and this is actually sort of, you know, the quadrilateral. So I'm sorry, you may not be able to read this, but this is K1, K2, 3, and 4, and this forms a four-sided thing in three-dimensional. That's basically your quadrilateral in your three-dimensional space over which you're calculating your trispectrum. So these angular terms can be sort of, you know, written out from this, from the 8-point correlation of the magnetic fields with the relevant operators. And then for a simple case, you know, one can do it for all these, but if you just want to write out what is the answer just for the constant terms for this, you get a mode coupling integral which looks something like this. So you have n here, which is basically that magnetic index. Now, to do the mode coupling, we need to do certain approximations. But then, so this is the answer that you get for the part of the trispectrum having done the mode coupling integral. But then the rest of the large number of integrals, we can do exactly for the case of scale invariant magnetic spectra. This proceeds in an analogous way, somewhat analogous way, for the calculation for the primordial trispectrum permutation. So we can do all these integrals analytically and exactly, and I won't go into all, you know, the details, but okay. We have an angular integral of three YLMs, which I can write in this way with an H and a beginner. I can then write the total, you know, trispectrum in terms of the angle average of trispectrum. This is actually the quantity I want to express the answer in terms of, and the angle average of trispectrum that I get sourced by the energy density of a primordial magnetic field of it is 10 to the minus 29. That's the answer I get. And now we want to compare this answer to the standard CMB sort of trispectrum source by inflation. And this has been worked out, for example, in Okamoto and Ku and Kokoro Komatsu. That answer is 10 to the minus 27 into tau and L, or 10 to the minus 27 into FNL squared, where we have neglected the GNL term and kept only the FNL squared term in the answer for inflation. So the magnetic field, so now we can put some sort of upper limits on the magnetic field by taking the 1/8 power of the ratio of the primordial to magnetic in a trispectra. Basically, sort of we compare them, and we know that on these quantities, tau and L and, you know, F and L, we have observed, you know, upper limits. So we use that to put, you know, upper limits on our magnetic field. And we get that the magnetic field is less than 16, you know, nanogauss, or less than 10. Sort of nanogauss, and that depends on, you know, whether you use the constraints on tau and L or, you know, FNL. So you may wonder, okay, this doesn't seem to get improvement over the bispectrum. Remember, from the bispectrum we got 3 nanogauss and 2 nanogauss. But this is for energy density, which gives a smaller amount of Saxworth effect. The larger Saxworth effect, you know, with a higher amplitude of Saxworth effect from magnetic fields you get from anisotropic stress. So having done this, we now can use the same formalism to do the calculation for the trispectrum or all the passive mode that is sourced by the scalar anisotropic stress. This is where it becomes really complex in terms of trying to do it all analytically. There are 16 times the number of operators, there are 1500 angular terms in Turkey instead of only 72. So clearly, you know, one wants to do it in a certain way. So one can get an estimate of the answer by using just the S independent angular terms, which are these. And we restrict ourselves to looking at those quadrilateral, you know, configurations which are equal sided. And we find that there's a larger amount of you know, trispectrum for the collinear configuration and this configuration is the tetrahedral. the amplitude of the tri-spectrum is now 10 to the minus 19 for the anisotropic stress. This is 10 to the 10 times larger than what we got from the energies. And using this, we're able to derive the upper limits of the magnetic field, which are 1.3 nanogauss or less than 1 nanogauss if we use the 2 sigma observational sort of constraints on FNL from the other. So you can see that now the upper limits of magnetic field from, you know, tri-spectra are three times as strong now as they were from, you know, the bi-spectrum. This is something that was not clear until we had actually done the application. We thought we might be able to put stronger constraints so that the tri-spectrum would, you know, would be able to do that. But now we've been able to show, of course, with certain approximations in the calculation, but we've been able to show that when the tri-spectrum can put stronger upper limits.
So what are the S-independent angular terms?
Yes. So the S-independent angular terms are these guys. This basically, this is the angle between K1 hat and, you know, K2 hat squared. So these are basically the angles between the K vectors, rather than the angles between the S vector, which you're doing to sort of integrate over. Because you have, you know, you have angles between the S and the K vectors, and you have certain smaller number of angles just between the K's. So if we restrict ourselves to just these guys, then we get the standard. Of course, you can ask that, okay, well, is this the full answer?
That's right.
Yeah, yeah. And so the thing is, at the level of the bi-spectrum, we've done the S-independent calculation, and we've done the full calculation. And you get the same order of magnitude, you get just a little bit of change. What we found was that there was a change of less than a factor of 2 in the amplitude of the bi-spectrum, where we went from just the S-independent estimate, you know, to all the terms. And for the tri-spectrum, what we've done is, we have not for the anisotropic stress, because we have large number of angular terms, but for the energy density, where you have few terms, we've taken the collinear configuration and done all the terms, and checked it, and compared it if we just take S-independent. And again, not only do you have same order of magnitude answer, but you get, I think you get agreement to a factor of 2 or
which one is bigger?
Which one is bigger? Yes. For the energy density, the S independent will lie. Whereas for the anisotropic stress, what we've done is we decided that here, you know, even if I take the collinear configuration, these 1500 terms, they'll become like 300 or something. So rather than do it like this, then now what I've done, which we're hoping to submit very soon, is that I've done the calculation for the anisotropic stress. But I've done it in the flat sky approximation. And we use this flat sky approximation even for the bi-spectrum. There you can do the angular integrals properly, for example. You don't need to make the approximation that you spent earlier, but I can do more properly. So that's another way to check. Yes. It's important to check. Yeah. So
what do you mean by stable anisotropic stress?
Well, the anisotropic stress can have, you know, different sort of parts, right? It can have, you know, the vector part and, you know, the tensor part.
It's
sort of irreducible.
What you meant is VI and VJ.
Right.
So
right.
That's a tensor, right?
That's a tensor.
So what do you mean by stable?
You can reduce it to a part that is irreducibly like the vector part and irreducibly like the scalar part. So I'm looking at just the scalar part. So there's an operator that I apply to VI or VJ which picks out just that part.
If I'm sure if grabbing one component.
Sorry?
So you mean just take one component?
Not one component, just that part, right? That's just the scale, right?
So the whole of the whole of YouTube. Yeah.
No, but I should be able to answer his question to his satisfaction. Take care. So these are the results that we got for, you know, the price spectrum. For inflation, it's 10 to the minus 37 into, you know, tau and L. For the energy density, we get 10 to the minus 29. And for anisotropic stress, you know, the price spectrum gives us 10 to the minus 19, which gives us now the kind of upper limits on the body magnetic fields of about 1 nanogauss, so just below 1 nanogauss. So on this schematic, you know, diagram, I've dared to place our latest constraint over here somewhere. Of course, this doesn't really make sense because scale invariant in a magnetic field is what I assume. So actually, our result is a kind of line over here. But you can see now it's gone down a little bit. So some progress has been made. So basically, this is the first calculation of the trispectrum from magnetic fields. It shows that the trispectrum equal. Let me go like this. That the CMB non-Gaussianity is a unique probe of magnetic fields at large scales, and this is the first calculation of the magnetic CMB trispectrum. In fact, we find that the trispectrum from the stress is larger than the one from inflation by 1,000 times for these parameters, 2 nanogauss and 100 FNL, and we get an upper limit from the passive mode for the trispectrum of 0.7 nanogauss. The first time that we've got an upper limit on magnetic fields about or less than 1 nanogauss. And the trispectrum, so non-Gaussianity does a better job than the power spectrum, and the trispectrum does a better job than the bispectrum at being able to constrain these magnetic fields. And magnetic CMB non-Gaussianity is also important because it needs to be well understood in terms of trying to recover inflationary and all the other kinds of non-Gaussianity from the observations. If they are primordial magnetic fields, we have to really see what are the shapes of non-Gaussianity. How does the non-Gaussianity run in scale? All those issues will also come. But right now, we've just done the first sort of analytic calculations of the trispectrum. And some of the further work that I'm doing is, well, I've already looked at the flat sky, and we hope to submit that soon. I've also looked at analytics for the tensor mode, where things become more complicated. You have to sum over all the polarization states of the gravity waves and the vector mode. And it'll be also quite interesting the work that we have just begun to do numerical realizations of the stochastic magnetic field, and then we compute these endpoint correlations on those realizations, and we can use some other techniques to try to quantify the non-Gaussianity produced by magnetic fields. And you can also have non-Gaussianity of the polarization as well as the scale dependence of non-Gaussianity. So I'll end over here with kind of summary of the talk. The cosmological magnetic fields, I hope you feel, are an interesting possibility. And that CMB non-Gaussianity is more sensitive than the other probes of these cosmological magnetic fields, especially at large scales. I've shown you that the trispectrum is more sensitive than the bispectrum. And that when we do the calculation for the trispectrum from the passive modes, we get a sub-nanogauss sort of upper limit on magnetic fields at a scale of 1 megaparsec. This is the value of the primordial magnetic field now. Currently found. Yeah, and this is the strongest constraint on primordial magnetic fields on large scales. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Pranjal. Does anybody have any questions?
So, with the model of magnetic the nature is fully non-Gaussian, so it's these are the kind of speculation theories in the normal sense of breaking down. So that's why we're getting like
right.
So it seems like the normal sense of constraining mathematics kind of is not proper.
Yes.
For constraining these things. So do you have any better ideas for constraining these things?
Right. I mean, it would actually be nice to not go order by order in the correlation, but to have an integrated measure.
And they could like higher order corrections through the lower relation because
perturbation theory is not doing a good enough job, then you're saying that the lower order correlation that you thought you calculated will then get some new correction from the higher order?
Yeah.
Okay, I haven't really thought about that, but that may be possible if the perturbation theory is not working. But here really, I mean, what we did here was a kind of more simplistic thing where we just took one kind of magnetic effect and said, okay, this is the bispectrum, this is the trispectrum that can be calculated from that. And just from that, limited thing, what is the upper limit that you can put? But yes, in fact, one will have to look at all the magnetic effects and all the different kinds of the bispectra, as well as the cross bispectra, which I've not talked about. Integrate them all and then see what data we have about the magnetic. So yeah, but yeah, I mean, there's some work by Julian Caron, I think, about how if you have nonlinear fields, if you just take the endpoint correlation, you miss a lot of the information in the underlying field. So I think he suggested you take the log transform and then do the correlations in the can get much more of the information in the underlying field from the correlation function. I haven't tried any of that, but that's kind of related to it.
And also the bias spectrum,
yes, so for certain modes of the bias spectrum, it's dominated by the local shape. But you see, we're just looking at one part of the ferromagnetic effect. So I can't say it's local type. I can't say that.
It's using the local types, like Dave's fucking squeeze triangles, in which case Eugene Sachs-Wolf approximation is going to.
Absolutely, yes. So that's a very good point. That, you know, Sachs-Wolf has a limited domain of validity. If you squeeze things too much,
so if we take Non-Gaussian, it will be, so it will be directly related to the knot. You can put constraints on the knot or
yes.
They generate it.
Yes. Yes. One will be able to break the degeneracy by looking crucially at the shape of the magnetic numbers. So that would be, in a sense, one of the next things to do, is to really try and characterize in a robust way what is the shape of the non-Gaussianity that you get from magnetic fields. And to do that, actually, we need to look at all the different magnetic effects. Right now, I just looked at one and said, okay, this is the upper limit I get. But so the overall shape will be a superposition of various magnetic effects. So yeah, I mean, if we detect non-Gaussianity, we could say, supposing all of this was from magnetic fields, this would be the amount of magnetic. But to go beyond that, one would need to do a lot more work to really get the shape. And the shape will help us break the degeneracy between inflation and secondary non-Gaussianity and magnetic. Because they all have fairly distinct shapes for different models.
So you have a lot of 1500.
Well, I mean, one challenge is the 1500, but that one can handle. That's not. The actual thing is to look at all the different modes. Both the vector and the tensor modes, the cross bispectra and the cross sort of trispectra, because ultimately you will observe some bispectrum in the sky, and it'll be like a superposition of all this. So one needs to have a good estimate of all this.
So when you say cross bispectra, you mean polarization?
No. One could also have that, yes. But what I mean right now, just for this, is basically if you take a bispectrum or a scalar with the tensor and tensor. But yes, you could also have with the temperature and polarization. Yeah. That hasn't been done by anyone. But yeah, that will also be there. Yes.
How much does the temperature depend on the factor of next?
Yes,
I think 2-3, and you said that's a reasonable value.
Yes. That's a very important question, actually. Analytically, the problem is, tractable if I just use -3. And so actually, the numerical values that I've given are for -2.8, but the integrals I do for -3 because they can just be done easily like that. If I were to change the magnetic index, make it larger than -3, then the bispectra do change. In fact, I can't give you the numbers offhand, but what I can tell you is, like, for example, in the power spectrum, the constraint from the power spectrum for the magnetic index being -3, the magnetic constraint is like 3 nanogauss, let's say. If I change the magnetic index to -1 or 0, it becomes 5 orders or 6 orders stronger in terms of the magnetic constraint. So definitely you will get a stronger amount. However, it's not clear that it's useful to take those magnetic indices because they seem to be well constrained by lots of other observations. So we seem to be going towards scale invariant magnetic indices from various other observations. So hence I've considered only those. But definitely you will get a larger effect and stronger constraints for magnetic indices that are far away from scale invariant.
Okay.
So forgive me if I mess this up because I don't know tons about non-Gaussianity, but for the bispectrum, the individual terms don't have to be, it's not like the power spectrum where each term is positive definite, right?
Right, absolutely.
So if you have a bunch of terms, can they cancel off the term that you
use? Absolutely. That's a great question, yes. So if you only look at some terms, or if you only look at certain approximation for those terms and don't explore the others, there is a possibility that what we think is a certain kind of result could be cancelled out by something we get attacked. So we've looked at that, we've done some checks. But you know, our approach has been to let us try to calculate sort of analytically a certain part of the calculation, and let's try to use that part to put the constraints. What we've done is that in certain, you know, limited cases, like the collinear configuration or certain types of the bispectrum, we've actually done the full calculation to make sure that there is no net cancellation. However, that's not the same thing as saying that for all the things I showed you, we have shown that there is no net cancellation. But, you know, so we've done some checks, and you know, there is no kind of pathological sort of cancellation.
Any more questions?
I guess I'll just ask one myself. So you mentioned at the beginning that, for instance, the bispectrum goes like sixth power of the magnetic field.
Yes.
And so it's clear that, for instance, things like Planck, which is going to reduce our sort of limits on in the FNL,
yes,
by an order of magnitude,
yes,
not going to improve our construction of the magnetic field by very much.
Well,
unless we detect it.
Yes.
So where do you think the future lies,
yes,
for trying to constrain the quantum magnetic fields?
Yes. You know, the future actually, well, I think you're right. I mean, Planck, if it finds non-Gaussianity, then we are in a totally different regime of how to use non-Gaussianity to explore magnetic fields. But yes, if it puts, you know, upper limits that are, you know, much smaller, like you said, like order of magnitude less, you're right. I mean, for the trispectrum, you know, it will be like, I mean, that raised to the power of 1/8 is your beam limit, right? So I mean, it's not going to change that much. I think the future lies in also looking at precise effects of magnetic fields on structure formation, because there are a lot of different effects. They haven't all been calculated and summed up together. And also in things like this, Fermi oscillation. I mean, they claim to probe femtogauss in magnetic fields. So even if what they've done is like circumstantial evidence, there needs to be, and there has been a lot of other effort, kind of explore that, you know, that.
Okay, well, let's thank Pranjal again.